We've had three drawings, right? The two contact positions, starting and ending, and the crossover. Well, if we get Bruce to do an eccentric crossover position with the knee pushed in towards his other leg and the foot sticking out at right angles, watch what happens by just changing this one drawing. You fill in the other drawings, and you get the most bizarre walk. Now, it's that crossover drawing that will help you give character to a walk. Now, these are some student films, again, showing different kinds of walks. These are pin figures, but look at the personality in that walk. And there are about eight drawings there, and the head and arms are going up like a bird trying to take off, which gives a tremendous optimistic feeling. This is a hippie, or pregnant woman, or whatever you like, where the body, of course, is reacting very little on the top. But even with a pin figure, I mean, this isn't drawn by Leonardo da Vinci, but you can see, it tells its story immediately. It's an uptight person, because you can see the stiffness up in the top, hardly moving at all. This is an old man, and you can see the one leg is going past slowly, the other foot is coming back, coming forward quick to give it the limp. This is John Wayne to the rescue, or the cavalry are coming, or whatever. And it's two isolated bits, if you see what I mean. The shoulders are quite separate from the feet.
One of the things you may have noticed in the films that you've been looking at in this program is how the pose and the action is exaggerated. Now, this is done by animators to give the film vitality. And this sort of thing happens in real life, but it happens so quickly that sometimes we don't have a chance to notice it. Now, I want you now to take a look at a rubber ball bouncing. And this is what happens when a soft object meets a hard object. Now, here we see the ball. It's coming down. It's distorting out of all sight there. It's really stretching out. And now look at it there. It's flattened out like an aspirin. I mean, in animation, we would hold on that for a couple of frames because, you know, we really want to emphasize that sort of squash. That is called, in the business, squash. Fantastic, that. Now, when the ball comes up, I mean, it changes like a pear. Now, in the next shot, you'll see the weight goes to the top. Now, look at that. That's fantastic. Now, in the next one, it stretches and zips off like a rocket. Now, we're going to have a look at an animated bouncing ball, where you see the same principle in action. So, squash, drag, and stretch. Squash is when something gets squashed on impact. Drag is when there is a delayed movement effect. And stretch is the rebound after the squash. Now, we use these things with more or less exaggeration according to the style of the film that we're making. So two-dimensional screen objects are given three-dimensional weight and volume by following the rules of drag, squash, and stretch.
The student was given the problem of what happens to an elephant dropped from a great height. And you can feel the weight by the speed, the clouds going by somehow. Now what happens? The volume spreads. Now this isn't quite right. I mean, it would happen very much faster, but the student understands the principle. And the great thing about this is you can keep testing. If you don't get it right first time, shoot it again at a different speed. Here's man. What happens to a man? He's heavier already than the elephant. And don't forget to bend the knees so that you don't go through the earth. At least that shows the resilience of the bend. And now what happens with the weight? You would see it actually go straight out the bottom. And it doesn't move, but the ground reacts when it hits it. Now, in our studio, a chap called Greg Duffel, who is 18 years old, and a trainee, gave himself the problem of weight. And he's got this film called The Cannonball or whatever. And the whole thing is how the human body reacts when it is carrying this weight. And this is, I think, from the point of view of weight, extremely successful. You can really feel that, feel this cannonball. Every good animator is tremendously observant. So watch people. Watch the way they do things. The great Disney animators are after 30, 40, 50 years, some of them, in experience, say that there's one... The main thing people love to see on the screen is a drawing going through a thinking process. And if we run a clip from the Disney Studios' latest feature-length cartoon, Robin Hood, you'll see all sorts of tremendously good, subtle facial reactions.
Our royal congratulations.
Well, thank you kindly, Your Highness. Meeting you face to face, Your High and Mighty, is a real treat.
Release the royal fingers. And now I name you the winner. Or more appropriately, the loser.
So what we're offering you this week is the Instant God Kit. You can create your own world in 6 days. And I thoroughly advise you to take a good rest on the 7th. Because here's a man who never rests.
If we close, we should, to wind up, if we could run another clip from the Christmas Carol. And what we tried to do here was use all the advantages of cell animation. The Ghost of Christmas Present takes Scrooge and flies him around the world in 30 seconds or to various points. And they go through time and space. Realistic things are moved in an unrealistic way or in a realistic way. The only thing we haven't used here is metamorphosis. But this medium has absolutely no limitations. The medium itself is, in effect, a magic medium. God rest thee, Mary.